I'm here today to put in front of you something that still fires me up a bit, and I hope it'll open the way to some give and take rather than me just standing up here talking. So I've called the talk Virtual Sex and Real Death for reasons that you'll see, and you can probably anticipate from those pictures what I'm going to say. And just a little offshoot to the side, I was just playing around with what I was going to present this morning at work, and I thought, I'll put a really pornographic CGI image into the thing, into the first, the opening slide. And I thought, oops, no, hold it. I can just see the headlines. You know, Warwick University psychology lecturer looks at porn on the internet, on taxpayers' money and so on. So I did it at home. But it says something about the traceability of everything we do, and it says something about the envelope. I mean, Luke referred to the internet as somehow extraterrestrial. It's not. It's the noosphere. There's the biosphere, and then there's the network knowledge sphere, which is around the world, and I suggest tightening onto it. Anyway, I'll get on to what I want to say. So you can see what I mean. These our two friends here. Has that got a pointer as well?
Yeah.
Our two friends here are pretty mild by comparison with what can be found, but they're obviously alluring, available, and disposable. Yeah, they're called Savile's favorites. This is Donna Haraway, who ten years before Virtual Futures had made a deserved name for herself as a writer on feminism, technology, and cybernetic identity. And she said this: "We're all cyborgs now." What she meant was quite nuanced, but that phrase will do. That sentence is quite accurate. Chimeras theorized and fabricated through technology. Now this, a little later, was Werner Vinge, who took up a famous essay by Jack Good, in which he said he thought, Jack Good thought, in about 1968, that within the 20th century, computers with the intellectual power of the human would emerge. Now, as one of the things we do with our intellect is to design computers, he said, well, in that case, we'll turn over to these brighter than human intellects the problem of designing the computers that will, in turn, and you can see what he had in mind. And this was taken up. Werner Vinge is a science fiction writer, but he called it the singularity. Jack Good didn't. But the idea was abroad, and very exciting it was, too. Now, here's Ray Kurzweil, surprisingly still at liberty, sounding off, as he did, first of all in 1999, just as the millennium was coming. The mind is going to meld with computing intelligence and then radiate into space at the speed of light. Well, can't wait. We've been here long enough, taken up by the transhumanists, celebrated as visionary. It's so transparently nonsense that the most interesting thing about Kurzweil is why he has such traction. Because who but Bill Gates and the founders of Google and several other people with more money than sense have poured money upon him to create the university of the singularity. Because having exposed himself in the age of spiritual machines, he went on to write a book and also a film released in 2010 in New York called The Singularity is Near. How exciting. The inexorable evolutionary process, the union of human and machine in which the knowledge and skills embedded in our brain will be combined with the vaster, greater capacity, speed, knowledge sharing ability of our own creations. Well, what would he do? It would be absurd if the singularity university didn't exist, but it does, and it's got money to burn, and it's burning it happily. And if you go to the site, you'll see that there's lots of goodies going on. Though interesting, the closer you get to it, the less it looks like Kurzweil's strange running off at the mouth, but the more it looks like biotechnology. But, you know, if there are any philanthrocapitalists in the house, I mean, please don't take my result, my dismissive result remarks too seriously. I mean, any spare cash you've got, I'll make good use of it. But they're on a mission from God to seek technological solutions to the world's great challenges. And they won't be about providing food or clean water, by the way. They'll be about making people in already rich countries richer and live longer, perhaps forever. And this is Donna Haraway, with her feet on the ground, recognizing bullshit when she sees it. I love that. Techno-idiocy. The word itself looks good, doesn't it? I mean, there's something right about that word. Stupid and silly, hardly worth commenting, except that it's powerful. Powerful people turned into projects. Virtual futures was of its time. It was, tons of it was wrong and silly and doesn't matter. And the bits that were right are the bits that are surviving now. And one of the things that won't survive the techno babble of people like Kurzweil is the idea that what it is to have a mind, what it is to be like something, and in particular, what it is to be an individual human being with moral impulses and painful memories, can somehow be transferred into digital form. It can't be transferred. Very, very interesting, important, significant, and exciting things can happen in digital form, but that transfer is a piece of electronic hubris, a category error. And Haraway, I think, sees this very well. You cannot virtualize the mind, but you can do it to the body. And one of the things that was sort of a recurrent theme at the virtual futures was cyber sex. Well, any publisher will tell you, getting a bit bored, throw some sex in, that'll sell a few more copies. And there was a bit of that going on, but there were some really serious interventions. Orland, the performance artist who continually altered her appearance with painful plastic surgery, which was broadcast on the internet as it was being done, was making a tremendously important point. So important that one of my abiding memories of the Virtual Futures conferences was Orland, who was a pretty striking, engaging person to encounter, was on the stage talking, and behind her was the film of her being cut and stitched and put together again. And the house was so packed that everyone had to be sitting on the floor, and a friend of mine called Aubrey, who is an Orthodox Jew, a mathematician, who works in the mathematics department, was sitting there looking at this. And as the full embodied reality of what he was seeing came clear to him, he rose like a New Testament prophet. He's got a beard that's out to here. And he stalked out, shaking his head. And I think somebody, realizing this was, you know, wondering was this part of the event, somehow sort of questioned him or looked at him in some way and said, "It's wrong. It's wrong. You shouldn't do that. You shouldn't do that." I think Orlan succeeded. It wasn't just shock. She didn't want to annoy Aubrey. She wanted to do something that was so unignorable that it would draw the minds of everyone who saw her towards the things she wanted to think them about. She wanted them to think about. But she couldn't obviously control how it would be taken up by different people. And for Aubrey, it was abhorrent. He had to leave. That's slightly off to the side. But there was lots of... Orlan was talking about sexuality, the sexualization of the female body. But there was lots of talk about cyber sex. People were going to have sex over the internet using data gloves and various manipulators. Never happened. People tried things, but it never happened. But on the other hand, sex on the net means, broadly speaking, pornography, which there's a great deal, and which has changed human sexuality. Maybe some of you read in the media about last year, I think, a sociology professor in the United States somehow discovered that her female students were removing all of their body hair. And it turned out that one of the reasons was that the boys they wanted to be with were suffering from what might be called Ruskin's syndrome, which was that pubic hair was a turnoff. Why? Well, because it's not that they didn't know that women had pubic hair, it's just that sexuality for them had become so associated with a totally shaved body that that's what they want. And then it became what the women wanted as well. So though cyber sex never happened, something has changed because of the virtuality of erotic power, the virtualization of erotic power. Cyber violence, however, is very real. Now, again, in my discipline, because we wanted to be like scientists, we fell in love in about 1950, 50s, 60s, with something called artificial intelligence, which was the idea of, you know, for example, making chess-playing machines, which we can now make. And the idea was we were getting to the core of intelligence. It had something to do with symbol manipulation in the head. Well, it's still going on. That sort of good old-fashioned artificial intelligence is going on, but it's a bit moribund. It's not going to last much longer. People don't do it. It's not fundable. What is fundable is artificial life, not artificial intelligence. And this is Bruce Sterling commenting on artificial life, which he describes as the attempt to abstract the logical form of life from its material manifestation. That's Bruce Sterling. And I'd like to give you an example of that. And I hope, Luke, you're around. I'm not sure whether this is going to work. Yeah, it is. Now, this is Big Dog. Paid for by, guess who, our friends from the military. It's carrying 300 kilograms. That's a lot of weight. And if I met it coming through the wood on a dark evening, apart from the noise, I'd think it was some sort of living thing. I want you to look at the next few seconds, particularly that. this. Now that is like two people in a pantomime horse struggling to stay afloat. I show that to my student and something students, and something important happens in that first clip where the guy sends Big Dog flying. In an audience of about 30, 40, 50 students, I can pretty much guarantee that a voice, usually a female voice, will go, ah. The sympathy is for the robot. And there's a sense of what a Quaker might call an object of concern. If you saw somebody beating a dog, kicking a horse, you might think, no, that's, don't want that. Big Dog is a collection of steel, computers, bit of energy, but it's crossed the border, it's hanging around on the borders of what it is for those sorts of things for which we have some sort of moral engagement. And in particular, it conforms to what the philosopher of cognitive science, Daniel Dennett, it requires the intentional stance. If, as he puts it, you know, if I see my cat sniffing around or twining around the legs of the table as I'm having food, I assume that the cat is hoping for something to drop from the table. I think the cat has an intention. I don't think the frying pan has an intention. I don't think this microphone has an intention. One of the themes running through Virtual Futures was the notion of new forms of intentionality, new forms of meaning, non-human forms of meaning, which were arising in the world. And I think in the case of Big Dog, we're seeing a very interesting intermediate case because it looks so intentional, and yet there are no intentions there. The quotation here is from Manuel de Landa, who was also at the Virtual Futures Conference, that there is the Big Dog paid for by the military is now armed and it will soon be carrying weapons into the theater of war and presumably will act as a sort of electronic suicide bomber. The drones have, as we know, been active for perhaps 5-10 years now. But they're still operated by people on the ground, but not for much longer. They're becoming autonomous, and this is something that Manuel de Landa spotted over 20 years ago. And just as Big Dog has somehow approached a border that is quite problematic, what is it that what's it going to be like when machines become objects of concern? If you look at the Christmas toys for the past decade or so, they're becoming more and more robot-like. And so we think forward, say, 50, 100 years, when children are given little furry things with big eyes that last for a long time. And that recharge their own batteries overnight by plugging themselves in, which have a little voice, which begin to know the voice of the child who's the owner of this pet. This pet might even have enough on board, or maybe somewhere else by a link, memory to have shared memories and secrets with the child, come to the child's call. At that point, if you pick that thing up and throw it in the incinerator, the child will be damaged, just as if you would step on its pet mouse. Will that change the child's aesthetic for what it is that is a matter of concern? I think it will. Do we need to worry about it? Not sure. I'll leave that one hanging. But this, finally, is Ronald Arkin, who is currently researching robotics for the military at Georgia Institute of Technology. That's a quotation from one of his articles that I had a quick look at. Perform more ethically than human soldiers. Autonomous robots that not only fight better, which don't mind dying, but are also better at observing the ethics of war. Well, that's quite handy. How are they going to do that? Well, there's this handy thing called the ethical governor, which is part of the elsewhere in the article. He takes as his model the steam governor from James Watt's engine, which is a rotating device which the faster it goes, the centrifugal force swings the balls out. That pulls up a little collar at the bottom, which turns down the steam and the steam engine reduces its power, the balls fall down, and the cycle hunts around. It's a pretty crude device. But it's an early cybernetic device, feeding back through a later model here with the system of levers to shut the steam off. This is Arkin's model, taken from Arkin's device. Sorry, Arkin's article about the devices he's building, where he thinks it's going to be possible to have some sort of device which acts to ethics as these swinging balls do to steam. I'm not quite sure how that can be done. But this is a technical part of the article in which he tries to spell out in explicit terms how he thinks it can be done. It can't be done. Computers can't have ethical sensibilities for the same reason that computers can't get pregnant. They're not that sort of thing. But as Manuel Delanda spotted, the impulse to provide cybernetic devices with a range of human resources, not just physical ones, such as the ability to move around, to locate things, to point weapons at them, but also the web of intentionality and restraints that surround a real soldier, including, for example, self-preservation, preservation of your comrades. The will to attempt to download that into machinery is so strong, so well-funded, so well-backed up by cyber babble of the Kurzweil variety that it is going to happen. It's not going to succeed, but it's going to be tried. And I'll leave that hanging and say thanks for listening.